Hey, what's up everyone? This week, I think I have a pretty cool topic for you because we're going to talk about feature flags. And I really wanted to make a video on that topic because I think feature flags are definitely one of these topics that when you first hear about them, they sound a bit complicated. But once you start to understand what they actually are about, you find out that they are actually pretty straightforward. And so let's get started by taking a look at the code behind me. As you can see, I've implemented a simple Swift UI view. It's a list that displays information about upcoming movies. And I'm going to start my simulator so that you can see what this view looks like. So here it is. This is what my list of upcoming movies looks like. And as you can see, there is a navigation link on each row of the list, because if I click on a movie, I'm going to display a detailed view about this movie. However, as you can see, this detail view is still a work in progress. And so what I would like to do is to have a mechanism that is going to allow me to keep working on this view in my development app while making the feature unavailable in a production build. And in order to do so, I'm going to have to define somewhere an expression that I can use in a test in order to decide whether the feature should be available or not. And that kind of expression that lets us define whether a feature should be available or not is actually what is called a feature flag. So let's see what are the options available to us in order to implement feature flags in an iOS app. So I'm going to get rid of the simulator and go back on the code. If we take a closer look at this code, you can see that the part I'm going to be interested in is that part right here, the part with the navigation link that allows the user to navigate to the detail view. And so what I want to implement is that when the feature flag for my feature will be set to true, I want the navigation link to be there and to allow the user to navigate to the detail view. However, when the feature flag will be set to false, meaning when the feature will be inaccessible, I don't want the navigation link to be here anymore. And instead, I just want to display the row that shows the poster, the title, and the overview of the movie. But I don't want to be able to navigate to the detail view. So how can we implement this mechanism? There are several options possible, and we're going to start by the most simple one, which is to use conditional compilation. And this is what it looks like. As you can see, I have added three instructions in order to introduce conditional compilation to my code. And what's going to happen now is that when I build for debug, this code will be compiled and that code here will be ignored. And the other way around, when I build for release, this code right here will be ignored and only this code here will be built. And with this code, we've implemented a first version of a feature flag, because now my detail view will only be accessible in a debug build and will not be accessible in a release build. The big advantage of using conditional compilation to implement a feature flag is the high level of safety that it provides, because when I build for release, this code is simply ignored by the compiler, so it's not going to be part of my release app, and so there is no chance of the feature being mistakenly available. However, there are also two big drawbacks that actually make conditional compilation not the best solution to implement a feature flag. The first drawback is that since the expression is evaluated at compile time, we won't be able to use this feature flag later in our development cycle once the feature is ready in order to implement either a progressive rollout or an A/B test. And for the second drawback, it comes from the fact that basically in a real app, we wouldn't use the debug flag. Instead, we would like to have a single dedicated feature flag per feature. And so we would need to create additional conditional compilation flag. And if you've already done this, you know that in Swift, we define these flags inside the build settings of our app. And so our feature flag would be stored in the build settings of our app, which are stored themselves inside our project file. And as I'm sure you've already experienced, storing information inside the project file is definitely not ideal, because it's a very big file and it's very hard to keep track of the changes we make to it. So now let's take a look at a second mechanism to implement a feature flag. And as you can see, for this second mechanism, I've created a struct in Swift called feature flags. Inside this struct, I've defined a static constant called isDetailViewEnabled. And this constant is nothing more than a Boolean that will let me know whether or not the detail view feature should be accessible or not. And now that this constant has been defined, I'm going to get back to my content view and update its code in order to use this constant. So I am back in my content view and I'm going to update my conditional compilation instruction in order to this time use my feature flags Swift struct. So this is what the updated code looks like. As you can see, the logic is still the same. The only difference with before is that instead of using conditional compilation instructions, I'm just using a regular if-else control flow statement. Now I'm going to launch my app in the simulator again to make sure that navigation link is still being displayed when this constant is set to true. As you can see, it's still the case, the navigation link is still there. But what's super nice is that now I can go back to my feature flag, switch its value to false, then I can build and run my app once more. And as you can see, when the feature flag is set to false, the navigation link is no longer there, and my detail view, which is still a work in progress, is no longer available. And so our feature flag implementation is almost complete, because as you can see here, I've changed manually the value from true to false. But of course, we need to have a mechanism so that when we build for development, the value is set to true, and when we build for release, the value is set to false. And an easy way to achieve this is to actually rely on conditional compilation once again. But this time, we only rely on it to set the value of the constant. As you can see, the constant is still being declared in Swift. However, its value is set through conditional compilation, meaning that when we are building for debug, the value of the constant will be true. And when we are building for release, the value will be false. And so I'm going to build and run my app once more. And as you can see, the detail view has now become accessible again. And the reason is that I am building for debug. And so the value of my constant is currently set to true. So this is already a much better mechanism, because this time our feature flags are being defined with Swift constant and not through the build settings. However, this mechanism still isn't going to allow us to implement either a progressive rollout or an A/B testing, because with this mechanism, the value of the constant is still being defined at compile time and not at runtime. So let's see how we can keep improving on our mechanism in order to make both progressive rollouts and A/B tests possible. So as you can see, I have reworked my feature flag struct a little bit. Before, isDetailViewEnabled used to be a static constant, and now it's just become a regular property of the struct feature flags. And the reason why I made that change is that it's going to enable me to create several possible values for the struct feature flags with different configurations for each feature. As you can see, just below, I have introduced a global variable called feature flags, and for now, it's just holding the same configuration than before, meaning that when we build for debug, the default value for this global variable is going to be a feature flags struct where isDetailViewEnabled will be set to true. And when we build for release, it's going to be that same struct, but with the value for isDetailViewEnabled set to false. However, remark that I have declared this as a global var and not a global let, which means that it's still possible for me inside my app to actually update the value of the feature flag in order to reflect a change that would happen at runtime. So let me show you what such a runtime change to the value of my feature flag would look like. First, let's take a look at the current value of the feature flag. As you can see, I am building in debug, so my feature flag is set to true at compile time. However, let's say that I want to change that value to false at runtime. A way I can do it is by getting at the top level of my app. I'm going to add an onAppear modifier on my content view. And inside that modifier, I'm going to get my global variable feature flags. And I'm going to change the value of isDetailViewEnabled. And I'm going to set it to false. And let me move the simulator a little bit so that you can see that I am indeed setting the value to false. And now I'm going to build and run my app for the last time in this video. So let's do it. And as you can see, even though my app has been built using the debug configuration, the detail view is not accessible. And the reason for it is that at runtime, we have overridden the value of the feature flag isDetailViewEnabled. It used to be true, but now we've set it to false, so the feature is no longer available. And of course, if we wanted to implement either a progressive rollout or an A/B test, we wouldn't be setting an hard-coded value in the onAppear modifier like I'm doing here, but we would be making a network call in order to get the actual configuration to use from some kind of web service, like for instance, Firebase remote configuration would allow us to do. And so that's all I wanted to show you for this video about how to implement feature flags inside an iOS app. I hope you've enjoyed the video and that it has helped you realize that feature flags are actually much more simpler than what they might sound like. As always, if you have any kind of feedback or reaction to the video, please share it with me in the comments. Thank you for watching the video and see you next time.